Just to give you some brief background on the club before we kick off the panel, the club itself was founded in 1904, officially incorporated in 1905, by seven Arctic explorers, because essentially what existed at the turn of the 20th century was this heroic age of exploration, and it really was the equivalent of the space race. Everybody wanted to be the first person to get to the North Pole. So what existed at the time is what was called the Arctic Club of America. And our seven founders were all members of this Arctic Club. And they sort of said to themselves, you know, we're Arctic explorers, but, I think there's a lot more to explore than just the Arctic. And so their ideas became the foundation of our mission, which is now to explore land, sea, air, and space. And our members have been very busy and active in doing so. We were the first to the North and South Pole, first to the highest and lowest points on Earth, and first to the surface of the Moon. And today, we have about 3,500 active members. We represent over 60 countries. We have 30 chapters internationally. And our members go on upwards of 600 expeditions a year. So still very, very active within the exploration community. Because, of course, exploration really is this ongoing means of discovery. It's curiosity in action. So there is still very much a lot left to explore. I mean, just to kind of give you a quick fun fact, we know more about the volcanoes on Jupiter's moons than we do about our deep oceans. So still a lot of work to be done in so many different aspects. And I look forward to telling you more about all of that later on this evening, when there will be some tours of the club after the panel and after the cellist. If you still feel like sticking around and listening to somebody else talk, you can feel free to meet me afterwards, which I'm very excited about. So please feel free, you know, if you see me throughout the night, to ask me any questions. Again, thank you so much for being here. And at this point, I would like to hand things over to Roya Moedel Obedian from the Columbia Alumni Association.
Thank you so much.
Of course.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Lacey, for inviting us and having us here. Good evening and welcome to everybody. And a good evening on behalf of the Columbia Alumni Association. My name is Roya Moedel Obedian. I really have been honored to be Columbia Blue all the way. I am a graduate of Barnard College. I was a Hamilton Columbia College Associate when I was there. I am a Columbia Law School graduate. And I am most proud that I am a mom of a Columbia College sophomore student. And I have two more kids to go. So you can always hope. What's so wonderful about the CAA, it is a organization that really encompasses so many different schools at Columbia. And it really is something that if you are not actively part of, get involved with us and try to be part of. Because if you open those emails that you get and you spend just 3 minutes or 4 minutes of your time, you will get so much back. There are so many events and so many things that are so exciting that are going on that sometimes I feel like when I miss knowing about them and people on our committee, you're so sad to have missed them. So if you open up that email, for example, this event is amazing. This is our second year. We are going to have more science-themed programming. So another event is coming. That will be our second annual CAA STEM Day. It is incredible. You're invited to come without children, with children, with your families, and it is so much fun on campus. There, it is really something for everybody, and there is learning for everybody. So I invite you. The event will be featuring an amazing astronaut who is also a Columbia alum, Mike Massimino, and we encourage you to sign up for that. There will be registration in May. Speaking as an alumni member, the CAA has been indispensable in keeping me connected to Columbia. And I know the same for many of us, and it's so nice because we are connected with one another. So again, I encourage you to check the emails. I know there's so many opportunities and things to look at, but if you just give that 2-3 minutes, you will get it back in so many different ways. So we are fascinated about having this incredible program tonight. We are exploring the health of our oceans with Lamont-Doherty Professor Brad Linsley, who will lead a conversation with colleagues Bärbel, Hönisch, and Andrew Juhl. After discussion with our panelists, we will open up the conversation for questions and answers, and then we will have a performance by world-renowned cellist Borislav Strulev and violinist Anna Borovik. To conclude, we will have a reception and an optional tour, and this place is absolutely fabulous, so we encourage you to do that, by archivist Lacey, who you just met, and thank you again, Lacey. Please join me in welcoming the professors. Thank you so much.
Well, thanks for coming, and thanks for inviting us to share with you. I guess all three of us would like to have this be more of a conversation about some of the big issues that we're facing right now, or we're thinking about. But first, we're going to start with some brief introductions about what each of the three of us, kinds of research we do, and the kind of things we bring to the table. So I think we'll start with Bärbel.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. So my name is Bärbel Hönisch, and I'm a professor here at Columbia University. I started out as a biologist, and I had this romantic idea that if I would study marine biology, there would be whales and dolphins in my future. And it turned out pretty quickly that when you're studying that actually most of what you learn about is plankton. So everything in the ocean is based on little things, and that's actually very important. So the plankton is a really, really big thing, and I kind of fell in love with them. And then I studied geology, and in particular in geology, there are ways of using plankton in reconstructing climate change. So basically there's a specific group of plankton, they're called foraminifera, and they live at the surface, in the surface ocean, and they secrete shells like snails, calcium carbonate shells. And while they're secreting these shells, they incorporate the chemistry of the water into these shells. And when they die, they sink to the bottom of the ocean, they litter the seafloor, and so they take this information that they took from the surface ocean into the sediment, and we can take sediment cores from the sediment, and because there's a layered system, so we have the youngest things are on top, the deeper you go, the older things get, and you can take out these plankton shells, and you can then analyze them and reconstruct how those organisms behaved or what under which conditions they lived in the past. And so my research is actually based on two components of that. On the one hand, I go scuba diving and I collect living plankton in the ocean and I grow them in the laboratory under controlled conditions. And I make a connection between the chemistry of the shell and the environmental conditions under which they grow. And then I take these calibrations into the sediment and I take out these shells and I reconstruct how the climate looked like in the past. And I'm specifically interested in carbon dioxide conditions in the past, in the atmosphere, and in ocean acidity. So ocean acidification is a big problem that we're facing right now with the rising carbon dioxide levels. And so why do we care about this in the first place? By reconstructing climate change in the past and by looking at how the climate system behaved under different conditions, we can actually make better predictions for the future. And that is particularly important when we're trying to understand how ecosystems behaved in the past in response to these changing conditions.
Thank you. Andy?
Well, so it's wonderful to be back here at the Explorers Club. It's a really entertaining venue. My name is Andrew Juhl, and I'm an oceanographer, and the part of oceanography that interests me the most is how the microorganisms that live in the plankton interact with each other. So I was fascinated by the same kinds of things that fascinated Bärbel early on, and it does turn out that even though the microorganisms in the plankton are individually tiny, in aggregate, they mostly control how the ocean works as a system. So for me, the things that are interesting are the huge variety of bacteria that live in the ocean, the microscopic algae of many different types, as well as the microscopic predators that live off of the algae and the bacteria. And so how that community functions is mostly what my research focuses on. And so I take a somewhat different perspective than Bärbel or Brad. They're more interested in using what has happened in the past to provide perspective on how the ocean functions and how it might function in the future. And I'm more focused on how the modern ocean functions and how the organisms in it function. So if you can indulge me for a second, if we all just take a deep breath. Okay, something that we do all the time, constantly, and we don't really think about it. But as you took that breath, about half of the oxygen that you inhaled came from little microscopic plants. I mean, originally came from little microscopic plants that live in the ocean. And so you may have heard the phrase before that the tropical rainforests are the lungs of the planet, and it's true about the other half of the oxygen in the atmosphere comes from the terrestrial environment and mostly from the tropical rainforest, but the other lung of the planet is the ocean. And that's just an example, one particular example that is sort of near and dear to us on a minute-by-minute basis, that highlights how the actions of these individual microorganisms, although they are almost infinitesimally small in aggregate, they affect global processes, like they can change the composition of our atmosphere. And so that's why you have people like me working at a place called Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory. It's a big part of how the Earth system functions. I think that's good enough.
Thank you. My name is Brad Linsley. All my degrees are in geology. When I got interested in climate change, a lot of the way Bärbel did, I started working with microscopic plankton and sediment cores, and I was interested in getting a job with an oil company. And right around the time there was massive layoffs in the oil business, and I decided that wasn't for me. Then I started working on climate change, and then my path diverged quite a bit, and I got very interested in very high resolution records of climate, where we can get annual resolution, where we know exactly the year. And for example, trees that grow out have annual rings in them. I get interested in the marine environment because there's these large corals that grow, maybe several hundred years old, and they grow about a centimeter a year. And we can actually almost get monthly resolution sampling these corals. So a lot of my work over the last 20, 25 years has been developing these very detailed climate records from large corals, mostly in the Pacific, places like Clipperton Atoll in the Eastern Pacific, and Fiji and Tonga, Samoa, also Indonesia. And it's an incredible amount of lab work. It sounds like I'm in the field a lot, but I'm actually not. I'm mostly in the lab, grinding away at the millimeter scale samples. But this gives us the ability to, some of these records extend back from the modern. We start at the top and they go down, and as they get older, they go back 300, 400, 500 years. And we can say pretty confidently that 1811 is 1811, and we can say pretty confidently that it's spring 1811 in these records. So we can see things like El Nino events, and we can look at the frequency of El Nino events in the past and how it compares to the frequency today. El Nino is when the Eastern Pacific gets very warm, and we have a lot of climatic anomalies worldwide. We had a big El Nino event last year, which actually there's been three very large El Ninos recently, 1982, 83, 1997, 98, and 2015, 16. And there's a lot of interest in whether or not those three events are, in fact, unprecedented within the last 500,000 years, and we're still trying to figure that out. We don't know. Which gets me to my theme. What I'd like to talk about in here is that there's a lot we don't know about climate, about ocean health, and how we measure ocean health. And I think back to a time when I was in college, and my grandfather had passed away, and I was invited down to clean out his, he was a carpenter, and I cleaned out his tool shed, and in the back of the tool shed, I was pulling out tools, and I found a bright yellow can with big red letters on it. It said pure benzene. And he was using this back in must have been the 20s or so as a solvent. You know, now we know it's incredibly carcinogenic, and we'd never use benzene to do that now. So I think that in the back of my mind, what do we not know about what are we going to know 50 years from now that we don't know now? I keep thinking about that as I do my work every day. So again, I think we'd like to have this be a conversation. We have some bullet points we wanted to talk about. Want to talk about how we measure ocean health, what parameters we think are important, and then what do we know about climate change, and what we don't know, and what knowledge is missing, I guess, is something else to agree on. But we don't have a lot of time, so do you want to open up for questions? And are there any questions?
I have always been wondering why we don't hear much about the cruise lines, how much damage they actually do, you know, in the oceans. Because we think it's great to take a cruise, but then where is all the garbage in the sewer? Is the sewage going? And, you know, this really should be more talked about, I believe. You know, what is your position on this? What do you think about this?
Well, I'm not an expert on cruise lines, so maybe you know more, but I know a lot of them have sewage processing plants
I don't work on that particular aspect of water quality, but I do a lot of work on water quality. I have been studying water quality in the Hudson River for about 10 years, and one of the big problems in the Hudson River is sewage contamination. Cruise ships are certainly very big. You have thousands of people. It's basically a floating city. They're supposed to process their sewage on board. It's really an engineering issue. I mean, they have the capacity on board to handle it, in theory, and it's mostly a question of enforcement. Some of that goes back to detection, right? I mean, you can't enforce unless you know that there's a problem. So I think it's the kind of thing that it's one of those problems. It's like, you know, there's the problems that we don't know about. This is a problem that we know about and we know what the solution is, and it's more a question of paying attention, measuring that something is happening and then enforcing the rules that exist, as opposed to other kinds of scenarios where we actually don't really know.
There is a website, Maritime Law, uh-huh. and it's really interesting. It talks about a lot of the problems on the oceans in there, and for everyone to look into. It's very important.
We need to be thoughtful. And I've been in some pretty remote places in the Pacific, and you go up on the beach, not on the beach, anywhere in the Pacific, there's just plastic everywhere. Plastic everywhere. We have a question?
That's going to be my question. Oh, okay. Plastic bags. I mean, I've seen pictures on the internet of these islands of plastic bags that are terrifying, choking all the whales, and I was wondering if you could talk about that problem and what can be done about it.
I mean, just being thoughtful about how we use things, but we need to do more than that.
We use a lot of plastic. We use an awful lot of plastic, and some of it is really worthwhile, and some of it is kind of silly. And if we cut back on some of the silly things, we probably would be better off in terms of, outcomes down the road. There's a tremendous amount of... There's a tremendous amount of plastic that gets into the ocean, and then what happens is it tends to fragment. And so people focus on the things that they can see, and it is, of course, shocking when you see a big lump of plastic. In reality, the majority of the plastic is in little teeny tiny fragments, and it's spread, over the vast ocean. That is one of those situations where we don't know how bad it might be, or whether it's actually innocuous. We don't really know that much. Things have gotten a little bit better in the United States. Recently, we are no longer putting plastic microbeads in everything, and that's a nice thing, because that was a really big source. And those little microbeads are actually very similar in size to planktonic organisms, and we can be fairly confident that those beads were getting ingested by various other organisms. And there's all kinds of chemicals that leach off of plastic, as they break down. So there's a lot of unknowns associated with that. In general, I like to take a precautionary approach to problems of pollution. So if we have some evidence that suggests that it's probably a bad thing, then it might be better to be cautious, as opposed to wait and find out later on that it was a really bad idea. So, in general, I think it's a good idea to cut down on plastic.
Go ahead, sir.
When you read the informed popular press, I'll call it, the big issues you hear about oceans are plastics, fish populations, sometimes red tides. Just hearing your précis of what you're doing, you're very specialist in these systemic analyses. How does your work or your concerns, when you see the popular press, how do those concerns really stack up with the issues you see as big issues?
Well, actually, that's one of our bullet points. We want to talk about what we think are big issues. The press, I think, is maybe hyping things up a little bit in some ways, which is one of my bullet points here. Actually, I wanted to talk today about, I think, how we need to depoliticize some of this climate change discussion that goes on, and talk more about some of the questions. It's not whether we believe in climate change, it's what we, you know, it's not a belief, it's based on evidence. There's hard evidence suggesting things are in fact changing, and we don't quite know what's going on. But back to your point, that there's lots of different issues in working in the coral reef environment, for example. There's issues of massive reef bleaching events, which is with corals when the coral expels their algae and turns white, and they may in fact die, and that happened last year quite a bit. The Great Barrier Reef actually bleached extensively. You may have seen an article recently about that. The bleaching was really widespread last year, and a lot of corals recolonized, but that's a global scale issue. And I remember another example in Tonga, we were looking for large corals that are old to sample, and we went out from the southern islands of Tonga. Has anyone been to Tonga? There's an array of islands north to south, and we were looking around the main island of Nuku'alofa and didn't see much, so we had to come back and pick up a scientific observer, and I asked the Minister of Environment, well, why the reefs don't look very healthy around here? And he said, oh, dynamite fishing. And that's still going on, you know, in some places, right? Yeah. So they throw dynamite in the water and damage the reef. So on the local level, fishermen, you know, are just trying to make a living fishing, and they do these things without, have no idea what they're doing. Just to the north of there, actually, the reefs were fantastic. So it's that in fact, that was a local damage to that reef done by people, which wasn't a global scale issue at all, it appeared to be. Local use. I'm not sure I answered your question or not. But
there the other. So you mentioned red tides, for instance. So red tides are something that we're obviously all concerned about, because it is something that may be triggered by eutrophication, by how many more nutrients you bring into the ocean, and how that will affect the population of these different algae. And we have a colleague who's working on that in India. And in particular, there they've seen greater abundances and frequencies of these tides. So red tides, I don't know if you all know what those are, but those are blooms of toxic algae that can occur in different locations. But they're not man-made. They're natural phenomena. The question is always, do they become more frequent as we're changing the oceans? And there is some evidence for that. But to really look into what we're doing today in terms of more higher carbon dioxide levels, more acidic oceans, to really see where that is going and what the consequences will be for future life, that's a little bit more difficult to decipher, because we can do all kinds of experiments in the laboratory where we can say, okay, so we're adding this nutrient, or we're making it more acidic, or we're making it warmer, and that will see a response in the laboratory. But very often we don't know how these populations will actually adapt to these conditions in the future. So how will the ecosystem as a whole respond to this when we provide these conditions for very, very long periods of time, for several decades at a time? And in some ways, the geological work that I'm doing, or that Brad is doing also to somebody in a different archive, is that we may be able to go and look at, are there times in Earth history when we had similar conditions as we see today, and did those organisms also prevail at those times, or did they actually wipe out other organisms at that time? And in particular for these toxic algae, that's actually very difficult to do, because they don't really leave much of a trace in the sediment. So that makes it very difficult for us. And so that brings us back to this problem of we have a lot of uncertainties in our work. We have a lot of evidence for what is happening in the laboratory that some of these organisms might actually be encouraged to grow. And so there's a lot of fogginess in there, and the question is always, so if it's foggy, do you speed up or do you slow down? In my mind, I guess we should slow down, but there are different opinions about that.
So, Bärbel, you mentioned ocean acidification. Can you explain to, maybe not everyone understands, why we think the oceans might acidify?
Right. So that is a problem that is associated with the carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere. As we have more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, that carbon dioxide will also dissolve in the surface ocean, and it will react with seawater, and it will actually make an acid that's called carbonic acid. That's a very weak acid. And this whole name has received a lot of flack, just because we will actually never make the oceans really acidic. When we're talking about acidity in the ocean, we're talking about a pH scale, and we all know pH 7 is neutral, so that's what we find in lakes, for instance, or in rivers. The ocean pH is actually on the order of 8, so that's a little bit higher than that. It's more alkaline than that. But we're talking about the change of the direction of change. And so when we're adding more carbon dioxide to it, we actually make the seawater a little bit more acidic. And in terms of how much more acidic is it now than it has been before the industrialization, it's somewhere on the order of 30%. By the end of the century, we're expecting that it might be 100% more acidic than it was 100 years ago. So those are big changes, and that has consequences for some marine life, in particular for calcifying organisms that want to secrete shells, like the corals do, or my plankton organisms want to do. There are many others, but there are also organisms that are just basing their physiology, their physiological reactions, they're affected by the acidity of the seawater as well, and so that has some consequences for that as well. So that's definitely one aspect that we're studying.
I was just going to say, to that point, are you concerned about the current administration's policies or budget cuts or anything related to climate change? Or what?
We're not concerned about that. I'm very concerned about what's going on. I think we don't know a lot, and with a relatively small investment, we could learn more. To not keep studying some of these issues, I think, is not a good thing to do.
Well, not studying it is one thing, but I think where we would have to invest a lot more is trying to prevent it from happening in the first place. So there are various different aspects that we're doing at Columbia and that scientists are doing in the U.S. and in the world, and that is one of them is, can you sequester that carbon dioxide? Can you basically capture it and then put it into a different reservoir? So there's a lot of that research happening at Columbia. That's obviously very expensive. And so that's why lots of people are very concerned about that. Should we really invest into that and pay for all this to take away this carbon dioxide that's not only produced by us, it's produced in other countries as well, more and more so in emerging economies and developing countries. So it's definitely something that we need to think about. On the other hand, there's actually a lot of research that could be done on renewable energies, and it has been done in the past. It's being done in other countries. China is now taking the lead on that, of all countries. So it's actually really quite remarkable. And I would say that it's short-sighted of us not to invest more into that, because it would create a lot of jobs. It would help us move forward and possibly develop lots of new things that we're not even thinking about right now.
Sir?
Yeah, so my question is, there's a lot of offshore wind projects being launched in the Atlantic off the coast of the United States. Are there risks associated with that as it comes to the environment, either in the water or in weather patterns that change because of these installations?
I'm not sure, that's not.
Almost certainly.
Yeah,
I mean, in terms of specific, I can't give you any specific examples.
So there are lots of
the primary reason that people have been opposed to offshore wind farms has more to do with aesthetics, I think, than other issues. I used to live on Cape Cod, and there was a plan for a very big wind farm off of the Cape. I thought it was a great idea, but it was ultimately. It was ultimately turned down primarily because of aesthetic concerns.
Mm. So. It's kind of sad. I actually grew up in northern Germany, and for me, whenever I went to the coast, I saw these wind farms. For me, that was vacation. I actually really liked that view. I think one of the things, so I'm teaching a course on science and society right now, and part of that is also looking into the carbon dioxide problem and energy sustainability, and so I looked a little bit into wind farms. And in the ocean, if we just think about the ocean itself, there are probably lots of ways of how you could leak oils from those farms. There are probably some ways of how you could chemically alter the ocean. But the biggest issue that has always been brought up with wind farms is on land the noise, which admittedly can be quite loud if you're standing right next to it, if you're living right next to it. The other one is the killing of birds, in particular when it comes to migratory birds. When I was teaching, or when I was preparing my lectures for that, I actually found a figure at some point that showed how many birds are being killed by wind farms and by windmills, and how many are being killed by cars, and how many are being killed by flying into windows, and how many are being killed by birds, by cats. And there are millions and millions more that are being killed by cats. And but then at some point I started looking at. I wanted to put that picture into my lecture, and I thought, look at this. You know, this is it's all the way of how you look at it. And I was Googling that, and then I found all these pictures of decapitated birds that were actually really decapitated by the windmills. And I thought, at that point, I thought, okay, I'm not going to put this into my lecture. It is pretty sad. But there are always pros and cons for everything that we do. And it kind of seems to me that what the windmills are doing is actually much less impactful than what many other things that we're doing on a regular basis that we've accepted as just regular amenities of our life. That have a much bigger impact.
I have a question for both Brad and Bärbel, which is the enormous impact of agricultural runoff and nitrogenous fertilizer in the Gulf of Mexico and other places where there are river basins dumping vast quantities of chemicals in the oceans. Is there some historical precedent for that chemically from some other non-man-made source in terms
in
of things you're finding in the geological record that might mirror the effect of that?
That's an interesting question. Like when there was lots of river discharge and wet times in the past, pre-humans, there would have been less of these human-made chemicals, but there would have been a lot of sediment.
Other giant chemical changes impacting the ocean on the scale of.
I mean, there's one major event, and that is the Cretaceous asteroid impact it just changed the chemistry of the ocean in so many different ways, because you know there was this. The shock reactions in the atmosphere that created acid rain, that created sulfuric acid and other things. So those are really massive changes that had a huge impact on marine life. But that is something that is so extreme that we cannot even compare it to what we're doing today. And it actually operates on very different, well,
different
scales. It's you know, in some ways it operates on different timescales, even though what we're doing today is very, very rapid in comparison to anything that we're doing in the geological record. I'm not really so. There are ways of how we can look at weathering on land, for instance. So you know, if we weather rocks on land, that has a big impact. It has an impact on the chemistry of the oceans, but that is something that is happening on the order of tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands and even millions of years. So it's a much slower rate of change. The one example that I'm aware of that is on a shorter scale that is not really geological. Is a colleague of mine who's working in the Gulf of Aqaba and who's been working there for years and years and years, and he's looked at the same kind of plankton organisms that I'm working with. He has actually observed how the plankton community has changed through time because of the massive aquaculture that's done over there. So there's so much effluence from the aquaculture in terms of the feeds that are added into the ocean that you see changes in the ecosystems. And so that's kind of those are ways. There's a really big advantage of studying places for many, many years in a row and studying them very intensely, because then you can really see what are the changes. Because from year to year, you always have changes. You can go out there with a ship and you're there for a week or two and you measure something, and then you go, next time you go again, but then it's a different season, so you see something different. And so there's some real benefit in having these long-term study locations where the ocean and the ecosystems are observed over a long period of time. And so this is one example of where that is changing. But Andy is really the expert in biology, so he might have many other examples for that.
Well, okay, so what's going on in the Gulf of Mexico is that you have a lot of agricultural fertilizer that's coming down. And the things that cause, you know, corn to grow in Iowa are the same things that cause phytoplankton to grow in the ocean. They're just plants. They need the same kinds of building blocks. So that's what starts the problem going. And the end result of that is that you end up with really low oxygen conditions near shore.
And jellyfish.
What's that?
And lots of jellyfish.
Yeah, the connection between those two is a little more mysterious. But certainly there's a strong connection between the nutrients and the oxygen. Now, there are many other places in the world where you have high nutrient inputs that then lead to hypoxic or anoxic conditions. So Certainly along the western coasts of most continents, you have upwelling zones where there's a lot of nutrients that come in. Off the coast of Oregon, off the coast of Peru, for example, there are places where the water column or the sediments can go anoxic because of upwelling. So it's not completely unprecedented. It's just that it's happening in a place that it did not happen prior to, as far as we know, it didn't happen prior to, let's say, the last 100 years.
Is the rate of change in the Gulf, though, unprecedented?
I would say yes, probably. This is kind of a dated problem in that we don't have a tremendous amount of background data with which we can compare the modern condition to. So we can see what's happened in the last few decades. And then the data gets really, really spotty. And it seems like, based on, you know, a tiny, tiny little bit of data from, let's say, 100 years ago, that things have really dramatically changed relative to 100 years ago. What they were like 200 or 300 years ago, that's actually very difficult to say.
Right.
So it's a qualified yes on that.
If I can add one more thing, since you're asking about, you know, are there natural events, there are actually some events for ocean acidification that scientists have been studying. And so in particular, when you're going to Papua New Guinea or the island of Ischia in Italy, those are places where we have underwater volcanism. And so this underwater volcanism actually brings carbon dioxide into the water. So you're basically bubbling the water with carbon dioxide. And you can directly compare two different locations that are, you know, essentially from that end of the room to this end of the room, that see a completely different acidification of the seawater over extended periods of time. And you can compare the ecosystem in those two places. They see the same sunlight, they see the same temperature, they see the same exact conditions, except the acidity is different. And if you put a tile into that end where the seawater is normal, and if you put it on the other side where it's not normal, then over there you will see corals growing, and over there you will see algae growing on those tiles. So those are kind of the examples of where something has persisted for probably hundreds, maybe even thousands of years, and the ecosystem has not responded to that in a way to adapt to it. Maybe it doesn't need to, because it's such a small scale and the organisms can move around it and they can go to those places where they want to be. But those are really interesting places where we can fuse natural experiments to see what actually happens if these organisms live there for decades and hundreds of years.
That reminds me of some work that I'm doing in the Gulf of Mexico, where we're using, again, sort of a natural experiment. So the idea is to study what happens when you put oil in the Gulf of Mexico, right? And this is obviously motivated by the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. Now, you know, the thing that was different about the Deepwater Horizon spill was that the oil was coming from quite deep. Usually oil is more or less a two-dimensional problem, right? The spill is at the surface and the oil stays at the surface. In the case of the Deepwater Horizon, the wellhead was at about 1,400 meters. And so when the oil came up, it had to go through a lot of water, and that changed a lot in terms of the impacts. We don't want to recreate that experiment, but it's difficult to study it now, right? So we take advantage of these natural oil seeps that are all over the place. There's hundreds of them in the Gulf of Mexico. Any place where you have a deposit of crude oil or natural gas, you'll get little cracks in the sediments, and oil and gas will be bubbling up there. And so on a very small scale, it's a release of oil into the deep ocean. And so we have this project that's focused on studying the impacts of these, you know, sort of small-scale natural experiments to try to understand what happens when you inject oil into the deep Gulf of Mexico.
Annie brought up one of my bullet points, too. I guess some other questions. But one of the issues in my work is that in the middle of most of the ocean, we have instrumental data where we've measured like temperature and rainfall or salinity, only going back to about 1960 in most places. It's very sketchy information before that. So we really, that's, I think, a key issue here, because we have a very short perspective on what's going on in the ocean, because in most of the places have very little instrumental data, even back to the 1960 in some places.
Well, and even in modern times, granted we have satellites, but there's a lot of things that you can't measure by satellites, and so we do a lot of work from ships, and, you know, the maximum speed of an oceanographic ship is about 10 miles an hour, right? So, you know, imagine, you know, when we were trying to work on the Deepwater Horizon spill, which covered an area that was, you know, the size of Pennsylvania, let's say. Imagine driving around Pennsylvania in a car that could only go 10 miles an hour. You know, it's really limited what you can, what the amount of ground that you can cover and the amount of data that you can collect. And then the other part of it is, of course, is the ocean is deep, right? And so you not only have to measure what's going on at the surface, but anytime you stop, if you really want to know what's going on, you have to go down, and to send a wire down to the bottom of the ocean takes a long time too. I mean, the typical instruments that we put down, they go down at about a meter per second. And so if you're at 1,500 meters, you know, you can calculate how many seconds that takes, right? It takes a long time for the instrument to go down and come back. And then hightail it at 10 miles an hour to the next spot, right? Where you do the same thing again. That's pretty much what we do. And so oceanography is a really, really data-limited science.
Yeah, just wanted to follow up on both things that you both were saying, the idea of the natural experiment in the Gulf of Mexico with oil, and then also the volcanic acidification in Papua New Guinea, and also Ischia, by the way, a place that is not too bad to be stationed. to what is the finding for the larger picture of that kind of environmental disaster when you have the oil, and then in the case of the acidification, what we're seeing for really the future of the oceans?
For the acidification, I think there are lots of scientists who are really intrigued by these islands, and it's definitely a disconcerting picture to think about. But for the acidification, we don't now, as I said before, we don't know whether the organisms really need to adapt to those conditions, because they could just, you know, their larvae could just drift around on the other side and go live on the other side, and they'll be just fine. So it won't really affect the community as a whole, because these locations are relatively limited in size, whereas what we're doing today affects the entire ocean. So it's, you know, the surface ocean is acidified everywhere. The deep ocean slowly gets acidified through deep ocean circulation, so there will be a much longer effect until we see that everywhere in the deep ocean. What has been done is there are experiments that were done to try and figure out, can we alkalize the ocean? Can we basically put base into the ocean to alleviate this problem of the acidity? That has worked out well on a small scale. But if you scale that up, then all of a sudden, and you think about, so what are we going to do? What are we going to do with the Great Barrier Reef, one of the most amazing environments that we have on this planet? It's not only the Great Barrier Reef. There are lots of little reefs in different places. And it costs tens of billions of dollars per year to protect such an environment. You have to do that year after year after year, because water moves. You're not keeping in the same location.
You're dumping something in there.
Right. And so that's, again, it's the other...
Washing soda.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mostly, liming the ocean, basically mining carbonate deposits on land and putting all that calcium carbonate into the ocean to make that dissolve instead of the coral skeletons that are living in different places. Who's that? Is that me? Or is that?
That's actually something that's done... pretty routinely in lakes. Mm-hmm. It's not unusual for lakes to be limed. Thousands of lakes are limed every year to change the pH, create a more favorable condition for, mostly for fish.
In the back over there, sir?
Yes, one of the byproducts of increased international shipping is the introduction of a lot of non-native invasive species into some of the waterways. And is this, you know, such as zebra mussels or whatever, is this something that can be reversed, or is it simply a matter of managing it going forward?
I'll let Andy.
Yeah, introduced species is a really tough issue. It's sort of like like that scene in Jurassic Park. Life finds a way. any kind of transportation is going to move stuff around, and you really have to be careful. And there's much better monitoring of, you know, particularly ballast water was a really big issue, and it still is an issue, but there's much better monitoring than there used to be. I think what we can do is we can cut down on the rate of introduction. We can be cognizant of what is present in our natural waterways, so that if something does get introduced, we might be able to do something about it. But in most cases, once something gets introduced to the point where you actually realize that it's there, it's probably too late. It's much like the oil problem. You know, like people say, well, what do we do about this oil spill? And it's like, you know, by the time you have an oil spill, it's kind of too late. There's not a whole heck of a lot that you can do. So the point to deal with it is before it happens.
In the back, ma'am?
So you've spoken a lot about unknowns. What do we know with certainty from science about climate change? And what do we know with certainty about man's role in climate change?
Okay. So we know, and I'll start with this one. So we know climate changes all the time from the geologic record. We know that the rate of change today in terms of global air temperature is, and global carbon dioxide levels is quite dramatic in terms of its, the rate of change is very high relative to the geologic record. There's a lot we don't know. We don't know what all this extra carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is, the exact effects are going to be, you know, in terms of how much temperature will go up, how much the ocean will acidify, how much the oceans will take up carbon dioxide. We don't know about whether or not there'll be effects on the, there's a lot of interest now also in the warmer air holds more water, and whether you're going to get an intensification of the tropical rainfall belts that are called the convergent zones on the equator, and whether they're going to move around or not, and how that will affect El Nino behavior. There's a lot we don't know about that because of this, what's going on. The view we have is only over the last 50 years, maybe at best. Anyone want to chip in?
So when we think about, you know, global warming, for instance, you know, you can always think like, so is it us? Is it something else? What else could it be? The other parameters. There's the solar insulation. Has the sun put out more energy? Is that the reason why it's getting warmer today? Are there other effects like volcanic outgassing of gases from the volcanoes or the carbon dioxide that we've actually known that for more than 100 years? That carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. And so when we observe how much warming we've had in the past, then modelers can go there and they can try and reconstruct that warming with all the other effects that we're aware of, with the solar intensity, with the volcanic activity, with the carbon dioxide. It turns out that they can only match the observations if they take carbon dioxide into account. There's nothing else that they can do. There are big discrepancies between what would be the natural climate forcing and what is that included when we have the greenhouse gases involved in that as well. And so that is really kind of the smoking gun, that it can't be anything else. There's really nothing else that feeds into that. We have, in terms of you know, is it ocean acidification, for instance, does that carbon dioxide really dissolve in the oceans? You can calculate how much carbon dioxide has been put into the atmosphere. We can measure that. It has been measured for the last 60 years on different stations in the on the planet. We have measured it in ice cores going back at least 800,000 years. I have done reconstructions that go back at least 4 million years. And in those reconstructions, the last time that we've seen carbon dioxide levels as high as today was about 3 million years ago. And that was a time when we did not have any ice on Greenland. And so those are all effects that we can put together, and we can see, like, what does this really mean for our future? And that does not mean that within our lifetime we're going to melt all of Greenland. There's something that we call hysteresis. So, you know, while there's ice there, it will stay there for a long time. As you've seen when, you know, with the last snowstorm, that snow lasted for almost 3 weeks because it takes, even though it was very warm, so it does not melt very fast. And so when you're thinking about Greenland, when you're thinking about Antarctica, that will probably take hundreds of years, if not much longer, until we really see a big change there. We see it with the sea ice already, but not with the land ice as much as you might expect. But so there are lots of things that we do know about this, and they're not looking good for us.
The only thing I would add to that is sea level rise. I mean, sea level is rising. I mean, that's something that's very relevant to people who live around here. Anybody who was around this area during Hurricane Sandy was got sort of intimately familiar with what happens when the sea rises up. We have pretty good data records for sea level over the last few decades. So far we have already surpassed some of the projections for what sea level would be under kind of very conservative assumptions in terms of melting of ice. So many of the predictions that have been made with regard to sort of global scale impacts related to climate change have already been shown to be happening. So that gives some confidence that well, that it's not just a figment of a modeler's imagination.
And if we melted all of Greenland, I think there's 7 meters of sea level equivalent in the Greenland ice sheet, but we're not. That's not even counting the warming or the expansion of the ocean as it gets warmer, which adds to the rate, right?
Yeah, I mean, again, that's not going to happen in our lifetimes,
right?
But over our lifetimes, it would not be surprising for sea level to rise by several feet in this area.
But it's good to keep in track, I think, of the end members that could.
Yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead.
So you've made a pretty persuasive argument that climate change is happening and we're causing it. And I'm just curious, do you teach undergraduates?
Yes.
As well, and I'm sure you teach graduate students too. Do you ever run into students who doubt the impact of climate change and whether we're the cause of climate change? And if so, or outsider students?
Why do you single out students? How about any? It could be anybody, right?
No. I'm particularly interested in students.
Okay.
These are Columbia students.
Oh, okay.
These are not Donald Trump
people.
These students, presumably, they're
reasonably, I see your book.
They're reasonably intelligent. And so I'm just curious if you run into your, if any of your students are saying, this is not, they wouldn't say it's not happening, but they might say, we're not the cause. People are not. Man is not.
So I'm not entirely sure if I as an instructor would ever find out whether my students agree with me or not. If they do not agree, they might just drop the course and disappear. I have once had a student a couple of years ago. I don't know whether you remember ClimateGate. So there was in 2009 when at the university at the University of East Anglia when their mail server was cracked, and so they basically took all these emails that were sent back and forth between different climate scientists, and these emails were taken completely out of context, or at least parts of those emails, and they went through the press, and there were lots of repercussions for the scientists, and lots of doubt in what the science really means and how the science is being presented. And I did have a student in my class who was very adamant about that and who basically just kept going back and back and back to that and wanted to discuss this and wanted to find out what was going on and you know, whether it was all wrong what we're talking about. So that was the only student that I'm ever aware of who's really been very skeptical about this.
But there are a lot of educated people. I was a professor at the University of Albany for 18 years before coming to Columbia, and one of my colleagues in the department did not believe we were responsible for warming. He didn't believe warming was going on at all. And if you look at the Albany temperature record, the air temperature record in Albany, in fact, it's not going up or hasn't gone up. But that's just a kind of localized little, and he was fixated on that, and he wouldn't listen to at least my arguments. But, okay, sir?
My question is linked to your comment earlier about driving around Pennsylvania at 10 miles an hour. When you plug in a GPS system, you have a reasonable certainty that you're going to go where you're asking it to go because things have been mapped. And I'm curious, with the oceans, what percentage of the ocean has actually been mapped, given that it's whatever, 70% of the U.S. surface or something like that?
Well, it's been mapped in great detail along the coastal edges, particularly in the U.S. But the open ocean, very little of it's actually been mapped in detail. There's been rough bathymetry. We measure the water depth, and we can make maps of water depth. But I don't know the percentage, actually.
Well, you all said that there's a lot we don't know. I guess my question is from that, which is, would mapping more of the ocean's surface be part of the solution, and is there an efficient way to do that? I'm not even sure who does it.
Do you mean the surface ocean, or do you mean the bottom of the ocean?
It's a good question. I guess a bit of both. I mean, the way you explained it, you're like, first you go to the surface, then you got to go down, I guess.
Yeah.
I suppose you start on the surface.
It depends a lot on what you're trying to measure. If you just want to know how deep where the bottom is, that's actually something that you can measure from satellite to some extent. But and so we have also most of the ocean is pretty invariant. I mean, it's flat. It's very flat, extremely flat. So you don't need a lot of measurements in some sense, but that doesn't tell you a lot of information about it. So it doesn't tell you what's there, it doesn't tell you what role it's playing in the system, and the big mystery really is the what's going on in the water column in between. Again, at the surface, we can measure a lot of things from satellite, which gives us some information at very high resolution, both temporal resolution and also high spatial resolution for some things. Temperature, for example, surface temperature, you can measure almost basically everywhere. Well, not at the poles, but sort of, you know, from about 60 degrees north and south latitude, almost every day for the most of the world. And it's just great to have that kind of information. Other kinds of information, biological information, you get a little bit more infrequently, but still, it's pretty high resolution and pretty frequent. It's really revolutionized oceanography, to be honest. But many of those things, you just kind of are, you can measure what's going on right at the skin of the ocean, and that's it. And then you have to kind of infer, well, if it looks like this at the surface, then it must look like this deeper down. And so that's why we have to put instruments down, because once you get below the surface, you know, you don't have any way of getting the signal back. And so you have to, so you still, there's still a role to for going out on a ship and putting down an instrument and measuring things. And that bit between the surface and the bottom is significant, right? And that's the hardest thing to measure.
Okay, wait, one more question about in the back there, ma'am?
Have any of your studies addressed the effect on marine biology of our overuse of pharmaceuticals?
Okay, so so like I said, I do a lot of work in the Hudson River, and right now I'm working with the US EPA. We have pretty much for the first time been measuring pharmaceutical levels in the Hudson. So what we know is that there are very high inputs into this particular environment. Of course, there have been studies in many other places, and in general, we know that where you have a lot of people, you get a lot of input of pharmaceuticals. The problem is more, what does it then do, you know? And
is that Prozac or what?
You name it.
Birth control.
So one of the things that we use for tracking sewage inputs is caffeine, because almost everybody drinks caffeine, and it gets excreted from our bodies. It goes into the sewage, and then you know it goes into the environment. And there isn't really a very good any kind of significant natural source. And so we use caffeine as a marker for sewage inputs. That is uniquely human. Right? I mean, there's other kinds of contamination that could come in from agriculture, let's say, but cows don't drink coffee. So if you had a bunch of fecal contamination, not to be indelicate, but if you had a bunch of fecal contamination from an agricultural source, it would be, it would not have caffeine associated with it, right? So there's caffeine, there's all kinds of high blood pressure medications that make it through the system. Antidepressants for sure.
Birth control,
absolutely. And it's a combination of the fact that many people take a lot of medications and they don't process all of it, and so they excrete it. And then the other part of it is that people are not necessarily so great about disposing it. A lot of people just, if they have pills left over, they just flush it down the toilet. So please don't do that.
Right.
In terms of what the long-term effects on the environment are, that's actually still a really big area of research. We're sort of scratching the surface.
Yeah. I think they're shutting us down here, so.
I guess you hear the next act warming up, so. Thank you so much, Professor. I hope everyone is enjoying the evening, but we are not done. We will now have the pleasure of listening to one of the most to one of the world's greatest cellists, Borislav Strulev, and violinist Anna Borovik. Borislav is a cellist, producer, and winner of many international music competitions. He's also a nominee of the annual Musician of the Year Award in Russia. He will be performing in two upcoming shows in New York City, one at the Kennedy Center on April 25th, and one in Merkin Hall on May 6th. They will be coming in. Please join me as we welcome them.
Hi, my name is Borislav, and it's a great, great honor, as always, to be here for this special day and play in front of you on this beautiful instrument, cello. My first composition is written originally for piano. Everybody knows piano is not here. The piano is a king of the instruments. because it's so many strings and it's so powerful. And Liszt, the greatest pianist ever, wrote a very famous piece called Hungarian Rhapsody. But now it's time to show you that cello also could be a king instrument, and I play this rhapsody on cello by Ferenc Liszt.
Thank you.
to invite on this beautiful stage my partner for beautiful music, Anna Borovik. She will play violin. So what do you think? Is cello could be as good as piano? Fantastic. I adore opera, vocal, singing. All my family are singers. And for me, cello is just an instrument which can sing. Each string represents different voice. For me, lowest, the C, it's kind of like Schalappen, the bass. G and D, medium, baritone. And A, Mario del Monaco, or someone very dramatic. And the top note, obviously, Maria Callas, some kind of incredible mezzo, or soprano. So now we're gonna play for you. Let's move away from Liszt and piano monsters, the opera world, and have this beautiful melody played by Anna Borovik, Casta Diva. Pianist, composer, human being, phenomenal person who came to my festival. His name, Michel Legrand. He did many, many famous movies, and he's just incredible, beautiful master of what he does and what he's doing. So we want to play a couple tunes of cello and violin, and I'm sure you will recognize this music. That's for sure. Mm-hmm. for your beautiful music. Cello and violin, two voices. We're gonna play a beautiful melody, and hope that all, and pray, it's called the prayer. So all the problems will go away. Let's pray for this. And the ocean will be always an ocean. Nature will be nature, and Columbia University will be best forever.
Thank you.
Bärbel. We had Monster Pianist Liszt. We had opera. We had prayers. We're missing dancing. So to conclude our program, let's bring some beautiful, incredible flavor and tell you a little story. It was a big exchange very long time ago between Russia and different countries, between composers. Some composers was going abroad and staying with very famous composers in France, in America, in England, and a few were coming and staying in Russia. So a friend of mine had honor to have an incredible lady who came to Moscow, and he picked you up in the airport, and she said, "Hi, that's me, I'm gonna stay with you for 3 days, thank you very much." Great, so they came and he played for her 5 symphonies, 3 operas, 25 etudes, prelude, everything. And he said, "Well, that's what I do. So what do you compose? Did you write any operas?" She said, "No, no. Not even one opera? No, no. What about concerto for violin? Never done it. Cello concerto? Never, never. What about quartetto, string to you? Or, well, I'm not really in the chamber music." "Wow. So what have you done? What did you write? Why are you so famous? You're staying in my house, and can you at least play something?" So she sat down and played that melody. So we're going to showcase you that. You will recognize and understand why.